Councillor Adrian Jones, who's unable to attend tonight. So, in accordance with normal practice, I'll just be taking the chair for 2 minutes while we have a chair for this evening's meeting. Obviously, with the changes in membership that happened late last year, there was no vice chair appointed at that time. So, we just need a chair for this evening's meeting. Therefore, call for nominations, please.
I'm Andrew Davis.
Are there any other nominations?
So, can I just clear up? If you're a cabinet member, can you actually chair?
Yes.
Is that all right?
Yes.
Because it's a
school in the bracket,
okay?
So, no other nominations. Please have a show of hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Any against? Okay, Councillor Davis, can you please come take the chair?
Can I ask you a question on page 15? Mm-hmm. Building, I correct,
read through, and I'm not quite sure whether we're going to see the changes to this register that was brought back to this meeting.
It looks the same as it used to be.
Yes, I know.
Yeah, so that is on the agenda tonight under agenda item 8, the corporate risk register. So it's got in that section when we come to it a report from Mike about the risk framework going forward, but it has also got in the risk register that should have come last time as well in there. Sorry, is that okay? Have I understood that right?
Have we had three meetings on it?
No.
Well, sorry, when I looked at it, I couldn't really see the difference, but presumably it will be explained to us.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, so. Okay.
So, Chair, also, I think it's in respect to minute 54. Members raised in the question, or was it to raise questions about power race? So,
they did.
Mark Smith and Simon Fox are here tonight.
Yes. Oh, yeah, thank you. Oh, yeah, oh, well, can I just sign these minutes with that amendment?
Yes. Can I just, yeah. Sorry, Angela, Chair. We asked for a report, didn't we? I didn't see a report on the agenda.
We've got a verbal report, Jack.
I don't think it was a verbal report. It's all very nice, but it wasn't what we were after.
I think I commented that the only documentation I've seen is the report calendars, and that I obtained some subsequent information from Mark Smith. I wondered how we were going to do our job thoroughly if we didn't have a clear view of the process of the changeover, what the suggested benefits were, even though we all know about some of the difficulties with the contractor and the contractor wishing to cease to have the contract. But it was to satisfy ourselves that just because it was all nice and warm and friendly and coming back in packs, we were still being rigorous in checking on how things would actually work out.
Yeah, and I think just to on top of that, Angela, I think I'd raised that I'd only actually seen that from a delegated decision. And given the scale of and the issues that have been around this particular contract, I wanted to be assured in paper, on paper, and all the rest of it, that the proper processes have been gone through.
Yeah.
When we're taking such a major decision, but based on delegated authority, which is different to someone coming to a meeting and being scrutinised and all that sort of stuff.
I mean, I suppose it's over to the committee. Would they like have the verbal report to be given, or would they like a written report to come back to the next meeting? Bearing in mind our next meetings, didn't you? Do you like?
I believe you read the report, Chair. So
people wouldn't like to have a verbal report.
Chair, can I ask if it's possible to have a verbal report, which then can be emailed to us tonight or tomorrow, so we can have it in writing as well. What we want is something in writing, so that we've got something to refer against. Because we can't really leave it much longer, can we? It will be a dead issue.
So is that a proposition then, that in terms of we have the verbal report tonight, and then we ask for a kind of written report to be circulated subsequently to that, then?
As long as it's beyond just an email of what was said here, but I don't know what's going to be said. Of course, there should be a proper audit trail in terms of us doing our job in terms of such an important decision with all the issues that, and the chaos that it's particularly caused, this particular contract has caused in the council over the years, that the thing's being done properly. And then we can satisfy ourselves.
Sorry, I assume that would be the report.
I got the impression it might just be an email of what was said at the meeting.
Well, I was hoping you were going to show something quite
fast. Right. Yeah, sorry, Phil and then David.
Yes, I can have a verbal report now. But I think when officers take the time to address the significant issues, we list the things that they've told us about, the specific things we want more information on. That would include the timescales and the preparations and the assurance that it's just got a case of transfer that's the frequency.
Well, sorry, I know we need to move on. The only issue with that, if you don't mind saying so, Phil, is that you have actually actually seen the cabinet report, they'd only went to cabinet and all that sort of stuff. I'm not sure the, I'm not sure how many other people have seen the cabinet report in terms of that. So, you know, you'll have a rough idea what was in that report. The rest of us don't know what we don't know. So I wouldn't be able to ask a question about what I've, I haven't got something in writing that I can read and put question marks against, because I don't know what I don't know. I clearly trust officers 1,000% to tell us the right thing, but that's different from seeing something in a report that we can push.
David, can I bring you
it's a very simple point, which is that I just ask one to note that we are still an ongoing commercial dialogue with the outgoing company, and that will continue for some time. That may impact on some things that we could comment on this time, because we still have any outreaches, commercial discussions to earn.
I've signed the official secret act. I literally have signed the official secret act.
That's what we need the dispensation.
Yeah. It was a minute in on the minute, so I was going to do it as a matter of rise and all that, on the minute. a verbal report, yeah. So that's what I'm getting from committee then, is that we go ahead with the verbal report, and then in as much as can be written then, you know, there'll be a report
later. Just a very quick one, when do you believe this report could be issued to us? If Steve is doing negotiations...
I think that's a question that we'd have to ask. That's not a question I could answer. I think that's a question we'd have to ask.
I think the contract ends in October. I think we'll be in discussions with the company for some weeks to come to
No one's
asked to be discussing commercial confidentiality. then has to be in a closed session.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can do that.
Subject to what's in it.
I'm not the point.
Well, exactly. So, you know, there are very clear rules about what needs to be, you know, in commercial confidentiality and all that sort of stuff. But we hope the maximum information is made as unique as it can be.
Okay, I'm going to...
So can I just ask a question, though? How are we supposed, as a committee, to look at things if we can't look at them?
Well, I think, I'm not saying that we can't look at them, we can't look at them tonight, we haven't got them tonight. So I think what I'd like to do is that I'd like to ask Mark to kind of come and give a verbal report. And then if from there we decide that there is something that written that we want, or, you know, that we need to have a closed session at the end of the next meeting in July, then that's what we would do.
Can I come back, Chair, with what Phil said, the council will vote by July, and if Mark is giving us a presentation, which we can't include the meat and bones of it because it's an open session, then why is he giving us the report? Because presumably the report won't have anything in it that we can't find somewhere else.
David, do you want to come
on? I just said it's part of the discussion. So high stakes, they've done thousands and thousands of jobs for the employees of the town and the street lights.
Or not, for
a lot. And there's just lots of events to clear out. These are relatively modest contracts now in terms of the council's expenditures, but £6 million, £5 million of that gets delegated down to subcontractors. It's 29 staff coming back from the council. And just to maintain the service, nobody's saying that it's fixing the stone for it.
Well, there you are, you see, that's a whole lot more information than we've had so far. So,
but Mark, can I invite you to come and
give
us a verbal report, please?
So, can I just do a check? We hear the report,
we
need to say we're
going to
get a written report.
Oh, I think we've got to have a written report.
Well, we've already agreed on what we put forward. I asked the committee, did you want to go ahead with the verbal reports? And what I got back was we wanted to go ahead with a verbal report, but then people also wanted something written.
But what they written before was something written, which
would be anything. Okay, but it'll take, I mean, I'm sure that report took a lot of people there, but something we can agree at the end.
It looks like it's going to be information down.
Okay, Mark, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Steph. Okay, so just by way of background then, so members will be aware that we've had a contract with Van Nuttall, which has been in place for a number of years now. The contract with them started in April of 2014. It's worth around £6 million a year. In terms of the kind of work that it covers, so apologies if some of this is obvious, but just a general background for everybody. It covers the carriageways, footways, drainage work, street lighting, signs and road markings, structures, winter maintenance, coastal protection, minor highway, traffic improvement, that kind of works. The way that when we procured the contract, it was on the basis that it would be a four-year contract from April 2014, a minimum four-year contract with the opportunity for extensions of up to a further 2 years, so up to 6 years. And the way that would work is that the contractor would have the ability to earn contract extensions as we went along through the life of the contract. So subject to satisfactory performance and annual review each year, they would be able to earn a six-month extension each year. So, just in terms of how that's run over the last few years then, so in the first 2 years, the first two annual reviews of the contract, in April of 2015 and April of 2016, the contractor successfully earned two six-month extensions, meaning that contractually they have a right to essentially 5 years. So the contract term that we were certainly working to up until several months ago was that we would expect that to finish at the end of March of 2019. Just a few more words around the kind of work that's involved in the contract. There's essentially two particular kinds of work. It's worth noting that of that £6 million we spend a year, round about £1 million a year of that is spent on routine reactive type works. That's mainly those day-to-day activities such as repairing potholes, dealing with street lighting repairs, and traditionally that work is carried out mainly by a directly employing workforce within Badnut or Irving based at their depot. It is worth noting that the majority of the value of the contract, around about five out of the £6 million, is work which would be what we call structural schemes, typically capital funded, and that's the kind of work which they would typically subcontract out and would be carried out typically by the big highway contracting firms in the industries, such as your Tarmacs and your Hansons and those kind of firms. The work has to be done that way because it's only those private sector, those big private firms, who actually have the wherewithal and the ability to do all of those, those traditional black top Tarmac kind of works. So that's very much just the background to the contract. So in commercial discussions with the contractor in the back end of last year, it did become apparent that even though Badnuttall had a right to essentially a contract up until March of 2019, in commercial discussions with them, by mutual agreement, we've agreed that they will actually only exercise one of their two 6 months earned extensions. So instead of running to March 2019, we've agreed with them that they will actually just run until the end of September of this year. So when we became aware of that at the back end of last year, we obviously then had an important job to then start quickly thinking about the recommissioning of these services. And that's something that we've been pressing on with since October, November of last year. So going back to autumn of last year, the first thing that I've got Simon Fox accompanying me here today from the commissioning support team. So Simon and Ray and colleagues started to proceed through an options appraisal process, and they used the HMEP, the Highway Maintenance Efficiency Programme Procurement Route Choices Toolkit, as the framework to carry out that options appraisal process. We have a number of critical success factors to work to, and those factors were covering things like strategic fit, aligning with our strategic aims for the council, achieving value for money, a solution that would be manageable and flexible, meeting the levels of the service required, something that's affordable, and something that's achievable and could be delivered within timescales. So they've worked through the options appraisal process using the HMET toolkit. It's fair to say that when colleagues have worked through that process, unsurprisingly, one of the major considerations is the timetable and that time frame for actually getting these recommissioned services in place for the 1st of October. And clearly some of those more innovative solutions wouldn't be available within that time frame. The upshot of the options appraisal process was essentially recommending that these services should be brought back within the direct control and ownership of the council. Now, when we say that, the outcome of that exercise suggested that there was actually two variants of that. It could either be to bring those services and those Badnuttall operations bring them directly within the council's organisation structure itself, or a variant around that, which many of you will be familiar will be many local authorities have an arm's length council company by which they're used to manage and operate these services. And certainly many of the large county councils around the country have a lack of arm's length company arrangement in place. So essentially the outcome of the process was one of those two variants of direct control. We then did a piece of work to look at, certainly the arm's length company approach, and essentially that is really only viable where you have an arrangement like that up and running within the council already. Essentially, if you've been able to tap these services onto an existing company arrangement. That clearly hasn't been the case here. We haven't got an existing up and running environment type services company here. So essentially the outcome of that process was that we were able to just bring those services back within the direct control of the council within that fairly traditional approach. So what that looks like in practice is that from October, the plan will be then that all of that routine reactive work that's worth about £1 million a year, those BAM Nuttall operatives, I think as David said, there's about 28 or 29 of them on the tube list. The plan is that they will migrate into the Council of Delivery Services to deliver those routine reactive type functions. The remainder of the work that has always been delivered by those private sector companies worth about £5 million a year, that structural plan maintenance type work will be directly commissioned by Simon Fox and colleagues in the client and commissioning support unit via a variety of framework arrangements. So that's the broad strategic direction of where we're looking to go. Just in terms of the touch points around the decision-making processes that we're looking to go through, the approach that we're looking to take for this, for the recommissioning of these services, is first of all, we took a report to the leader of the council at the end of November, really looking for approval of of that strategic direction of where we're looking to go. We're pressing on with the recommissioning new procurement now, and importantly, you will have noticed from the council's forward plan that we are due to come back, we're on the forward plan for April time, with a final business case decision report, which is really that final point where we look for political approval to award the contracts and the frameworks and the arrangements. So just in terms of those political decision making, first of all, the business committee, members of that scrutiny committee, have been very interested in this procurement exercise, as has been highlighted here. So at the end of the month, on the 27th of March, the business committee want a full update from myself, Simon and colleagues. They've asked for a report and presentation, which is being prepared as we speak, to give a full update presentation to that committee in terms of that pre-scrutiny update. And then obviously we're down for a key decision in April time, and obviously members will be able to use the usual calling process as a part of that to carry out scrutiny and challenges in that usual way. So I think that's it in terms of a broad overview, Chair, and then I think between myself, Simon and Ray, we're happy to take any questions and obviously come back with either further reports to this committee or even bearing in mind some of the time frames. We'd be very happy to try and circulate information to members offline just to try and give some reassurance about the robustness of the approach that we're following.
Okay, questions?
Yeah, a couple of things, if I may. Maybe I've got we talk about £1 million, 28 people, 2 peeing in. Well, I can work with 20, if you say on average 25, I don't know the average salary, but that's probably close to an average salary. That comes out at 700,000. in terms of what we're bringing. So it strikes me as there's actually £300,000 worth of material being put around, which seems a bit odd. The other thing is, you mentioned it was a 4-year contract. So while I can understand when you've got a contract of a particular length, how can it come as a surprise when it comes to an end? Because you know how long the contract is. You know in terms of when it has to be renegotiated. How can it be such a surprise that it can only be done under delegated authority? I would have expected something along the lines of some sort of strategic outline business case with those options that you've just discussed laid out. But to say, oh, it's all too late, really this is the only option we can go to, it's a traditional option, as opposed to something more, you know, more flexible that might add more value to the business and to, you know, make the pound, our pounds go further, the pounds, taxpayers' pounds go further. We don't have time to really look at all that because this is the only option on the table. Haven't even, from what I can tell, discussed about partnering with a different authority. I don't know, Liverpool, Cheshire West, whatever. One presumes there are, given we're talking about what I can see about £300,000 worth of bits actually being put on the road or on a light. You would think that there would be options for partnering. And the other thing I'm still not clear about is if we had, or if we have this contract, and again, I don't know what the value for money statement is around that contract and how money is spent. But if we're letting the contract out early, then that is that going to end up costing us more? So obviously, it's a contract saying, you talk about commercial. They're doing well, you know, we're not making any money on this and it's costing us more than we'd like to get out. Why are we letting them get out? In terms of, because, you know, that was the arrangements, they were the rules where people tendered for it in the first place. You can't tender for something, win it, and they say, oh, do you know what? It's either give us more money or, you know, it's costing us too much, we want to get out. That was the rules at the beginning of the process. And people should be held to that. And so, coming back to it, continues, is 4-year contract, why did it all come to a head of a rush? Who is supposed to be managing these contracts and contractors? 28 people, 25,000 is 700,000, which seems a bit odd if you say that's only responsible for 1 million. And we still haven't, sorry, it seems a comment, that's okay. And the other concern I've got is, how much is it now going to cost for our procurement team to actually organise all the procurements? Because apparently this group that we're taking back in-house aren't going to be doing the procurements, because that's going to be, and how much is that going to be costing? And has that been thrown into it? So, I have more questions than you were able to provide answers.
I'll have a go at some of those.
Do you want to get the other questions and then because there might be some that you can wrap up together?
Okay.
Is that okay? So we had Paul and then Christina.
Yeah, personally, welcome to bring the service back in. I see that's a really positive situation for us. With regards to the procurement exercise then, so if we're taking the main contractor out of the scenario, so we're going to deal directly with the subcontractors, I'm seeing potentially there's some savings there, and would that be offset then against the procurement costs? Perhaps you could comment on that, that would be great.
Christina,
that's
I also welcome them coming back in. I don't think I'm alone in council trying to say when I say road signs, road services and street lighting take a lot of our time for constituents. I am I right in assuming that you're saying a million because you know, if it's just going to say 25,000, you'd have on costs as well, which would take it up. What I'm concerned about is though that work has been done. I know nothing about roads, I just know I have to walk across them. And I have been very happy with what I've seen, especially in my road, which hasn't been just 12 months, and it's already worn out. So, will these 29 people and Buses Borough Road Council have to go back and redo a lot of work that was not done properly in the eyes of the public? Are you opening the window?
Yeah. Come to open the door?
Yes, please. I call it. And also, will I noticed until I can only give my own road directly. As an example, we only got somebody from Wimbledon Council out to check the work, the original work that was then being done itself. When we made a big fuss, would it be anything now? Because it's our workers, would it be easier to get somebody to check that the work's been done?
Okay, Ron, and then.
Yeah, I'll just pick up on the point from Jeff, right? Is that the contract being tied into the contract that they originally I'm unsure because Scarlett, and maybe I'm wrong, but I'm not sure of the vice, there's potential for them to an extension to the contract up to 4 years, which they did then, the contract should have finished April 2018. So they are operating with one extension until the end too. But then extensions are literally to be, the obligated to continue through to April next year. Well, they think, because the contract says that fix, they have to deliver that on it. Because recently, the DNA's in June during 2017. I would think probably not.
The complaints that is out there, and they have another extension.
But it'd be interesting to know whether that's tied into, or have we released them from that obligation because it's in our interest to release them because of the policy that we had throughout 2017.
Well,
some of
you
want your hands on. Just to start with Paul's point, Paul, Councillor Durfee recommended as a positive move. No objections to positive move. What we want is it proved to be positive. Where I start from is a little bit of history. And I'm sort of glad that David Elton was next. A couple of years ago, when grass cutting was brought back in, we were faced with having to buy plant to replace, because the previous contractor had plant. Previous contractor, the tenders were on the basis that the contractor would lease plant and provide it to us. When we took grass cutting back in, we suddenly found, that was such plant as we had left was, shall we say, past its best. And the plant the contractor had was super duper stuff, and we had to then go out to Ransoms and John Deere, sort of a list of Kubota and all sorts of contractors and get a plant quickly. So I remember the names because I've got them. So we had to get this equipment. So in this costing in the case, first of all, we're looking for, I can remember, many of them, presumably orders are issued. And I've seen paperwork about orders, and I've seen 70 square metres here, there, and everywhere, and I've followed the trails. What we're looking for is output systems that stop there being a paper chase for, systems that are happy about the quality for. Christine has mentioned quality. I think it's not just a matter of contractors, but modern materials seem to me to be less tactile. There's something about them, it's not the good old days of them with the steamroller throwing chippings down on top. We haven't seen that apart from roots, keep bus routes for years. It's sealing roads with materials that's got a great grip in to keep water out. That's what we're doing in order to manage our budgets. So we're looking at a positive case, avoiding the paper chase, and what I call flexibility. That the thing that frustrates the public is in Lindale Avenue in Easton, there were 19 holes that I photographed and sent pictures of in, and I said, can we do them all at the same time, please, rather than people coming along in stages? And to be fair, it was actually organised. What the public get frustrated about is they did that one, they did that one, they did that one.
Yes.
But they went past that one, yes, which has developed since. I've got flexibility to actually tackle things. I mentioned plans and equipment, now comes to supervision. The paperwork I saw, I'll be careful, suggested that we then had to set up supervision and management arrangements. Because there were people doing within our house network, and there were some people over there doing it from their side, and we have to have managed supervision arrangements that were as part of the new contract. So I'm looking for assurances from this company that it wasn't just, this looks all right, this is a great idea. Sorry, my recollection of the report, so I don't offend Mr. Smith, was about 10 pages, 15 pages in the first report, about 25, 30 in the next report I saw. But as a committee, we should be able to track all these different decisions pointing one direction or another, followed through, and it wasn't just, that looks a good idea, it looks convenient, we'll go for it.
Just a very quick one, they really. Did the option of going for another contractor similar to Van Nuttall enter into the equation. And that was dismissed for one reason.
Regardless,
I'll have a go at trying to transform it. So bear with me, see how we go. So, around the 28 or 29 FTs, so. Yeah, just to be clear, we associate those people, the Van Nuttall people, with the those direct people with the routine reactive work, but actually in practice, getting into the detail of the job roles, round about half of those people are operational people on the ground that do the filling the potholes and those kind of operational tasks. There's an element of kind of management admin, supervisory side, which does cover delivering the planned works as well. So just to clarify, all of those 20, they're not all those operational people just associated with it. It includes back office and admin as well. Just in terms of the context by which we have the extensions and the way the contract works. So the contract, when it was let, is fundamentally on the basis that the contractor can earn extensions as he goes along. I must be honest, it's on the premise that if a contractor is making money and it's commercially viable for him, there's an assumption there that as he earns extensions, as he goes along, he's going to want to exercise his right to have those extensions, and certainly have that right. So, I think certainly from an officer point of view, and in that period of last year, once we got past, so the second extension awarded would have been summer of 16, and certainly as the lead officer for that arrangement at the time, we're then in a position where we have a contractor who we expect to want to run until March of 2019. Just to be clear, he has a right to that extension if he wants to exercise that right. And if it's a commercially successful contract for him, we assume that that